This is a diagram of a turbine, which we use in thermodynamics, and the turbine is used to generate shaft work, and it does so by extracting energy from a high-pressure, high-temperature stream of fluid that enters the turbine. It expands within the turbine, and then it exits at a lower temperature and a lower pressure. And the difference between the high energy of the fluid flowing into it and the low energy of the fluid leaving it, that net difference is the shaft work that the turbine generates. To make that happen, the insides of the turbine have to be incredibly intricate, but from a thermodynamic standpoint, we don't care about what goes on within this black box. All we care about is the flow of energy. What we would say is that if this system is running under steady conditions, the total rate of all forms of energy entering our system is equal to the total rate of all forms of energy leaving. So I'll draw a control volume around the turbine. And what we're concerned with are all the different ways energy can flow into it. Obviously, energy will flow in from the high-pressure, high-temperature steam entering the turbine. It'll leave as the lower-temperature, lower-pressure steam. It'll also leave as shaft work, which we desire. So there's various ways energy can get into the turbine. We can have internal energy entering. There can be kinetic energy of the fluid entering, and potential energy of the fluid entering. So these three forms of energy enter the turbine at this location. One form of energy that's real easy to forget, and it's not terribly intuitive, is known as flow energy, or flow work. And it's the work required by the upstream fluid to push the downstream fluid into the turbine. To conceptualize this, I've deleted the majority of the feed, and I put a little piston cylinder device here. And the syringe needs to push the downstream fluid into the turbine. And that requires a downward force on the plunger. That force I'll call F1. And that force is equal to the pressure at point 1 multiplied by the cross-sectional area of the pipe, A1. And over a period of time, this plunger is displaced a distance, L1, and I can define the amount of flow work, W flow, as equal to the force times the length, F1, L1. And you can show that this is equal to P1 times the displaced volume. And the rate at which flow work is entering the system, W flow dot, is equal to the derivative ddt of P1 V1. If the pressure is constant, that's equal to P1 dV1 dt. Or I can say P1 dm V1 hat dt. And since V1 hat, the specific volume at state 1, is a constant, I'll end up with m dot times P V1. And this is the rate at which flow work enters a system, or we'd say the rate at which PV work enters a system. So to demonstrate this, the upstream fluid is pushing the fluid down into the turbine, and it's doing flow work. Not only does the fluid have to push fluid into the fluid leaving the turbine has also got to push its downstream fluid out against some pressure, P2. So we look at the flow work at state 2, the exhaust of the turbine, some work is leaving the system. So here we see fluid pushing this plunger along as it exhausts the turbine. So again, if we look at our energy balance, we've got internal energy entering associated with molecular interactions. And in addition to kinetic and potential energy, we also need to account for this flow energy entering. So here are the four forms of energy entering the system. At steady state, that has to equal the total rate at which all forms of energy leave the control volume. Those four are equal to the internal energy leaving, the flow energy leaving that the system is doing, plus any kinetic and potential energies leaving. But there's also one other form of energy leaving, so I need to add that into my energy balance. So I'll say plus shaft work. And with a turbine, this is what we're primarily interested in. And let me write this symbolically. In a nutshell, these four forms of energy are large entering the turbine relative to the four forms of energy leaving the turbine. That means that this turbine can produce a great deal of shaft work. In other words, if it can extract a lot of this energy, it can do more shaft work. And we can simplify this a bit by saying that the mass flow entering the system has to equal the mass flow leaving the system at steady state. And let's just drop the subscripts and just call it m dot. And I'll rearrange this expression. Again, I factored out the mass flows. One thing to look at and to keep in mind is that these terms, they're often seen in analysis of thermodynamic systems. And they're seen so much, in fact, that for a matter of convenience, we'll say that this U1 plus P1 V hat 1, we're going to call it H1. And we'll give that H a name, we'll call it enthalpy. So I'm going to solve for W out now and make that substitution for H. An assumption that we can often make is that these terms, as H1 and H2, are usually fairly large compared to the kinetic and potential energy differences. And they're so large, in fact, that it may only make a percent or two difference. If we're trying to calculate W out, we might get by just saying W out is equal to the mass flow rate through the turbine times the enthalpy of the stream entering minus H2. In analyzing this system, if I come back to the diagram, or what you're often available to you is the temperature and the pressure at the inlet or in point one, and I can use those to look up H1. And oftentimes I've got a T2 and P2, and I can use those to look up H2. And when I want to find the work that the turbine is generating, if I know the mass flow rate, I know H1 and I know H2, the amount of enthalpy extracted from the stream is effectively equal to the shaft work that the turbine is producing. Lastly, I want to note that I don't need to use enthalpy to solve these problems. As long as I've got a conceptual feel for what internal energy means and a conceptual feel for what flow work means, I could use this relationship H1 is equal to U1 plus P1 times the specific volume at state 1. That's all I need. If I go down, I've got a piece of a table for superheated steam. And if I look at this, here's superheated steam at a pressure of 1 megapascal. So let's say that P1 is equal to 1 megapascal. And if I knew that the temperature, for example, is equal to 500 degrees C, I want to show you that I don't even need this enthalpy column. I know that H is equal to U plus P times the specific volume, if I plug in numbers for U, P, and V. And when I do this calculation, what I come up with is a value of 3479.1 kilojoules per kilogram. And that is the exact same value for enthalpy. And this column for H is completely redundant. I don't need it whatsoever. But it's really nice, because otherwise I would have to make this calculation over and over again. And because we see it so often in thermodynamic analysis, for convenience, they've added this extra column.